Welcome to The Link, highlighting entrepreneurial paths with U Ottawa alumni from around the world. Listen in to hear how people from a multitude of backgrounds have made their ideas and passions come to life. We'll explore the steps they took, the issues they overcame, and their lessons learned. My name is Sharon Wong. I'm a University of Ottawa alum who does marketing consulting for both startups and corporations, and your host for this series.
Our guest today is Aminka Belvitt. Aminka's work focuses on diversity and inclusion training and women leadership. She's an international speaker and award-winning entrepreneur, founder of For Us Girls, a new reality tech summit for girls, and Wolfen Solutions. Aminka is also a goalkeeper with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, a UN Women Champion of Women's Economic Empowerment and Humanitarian, and Senior Strategy Consultant. Recently, she was awarded the Entrepreneur of the Year Award by the Canadian Consulate General in New York. Aminka received her Bachelor of Public Administration and Political Science at the University of Ottawa. Welcome, Aminka, to The Link. Thank you for speaking with us today.
Yes, thank you so much for having me, Sharon. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be part of this episode.
Women leadership and women in tech is near and dear to my heart, so I am so excited for this interview. Let's jump right in.
Yeah.
So you founded the For Us Girls Foundation. What was the inspiration behind this?
Yeah, so I've always been a really active citizen. Citizenship has always been very important to me in the terms of we are responsible for our community, we're responsible for our government, and the experiences that we have in the world. I always feel that the institutions that are public institutions, even though I'm a person of color and sometimes we're taught these spaces aren't created for us or they aren't as safe for us, I always felt we were entitled to these spaces. And I think, again, based on my education, these are public entities. And so therefore, our tax dollars go to them, and these are something that we should hold people accountable. So I've always had that vision. And so I was volunteering in different organizations. In high school, I worked at the Heart and Stroke Foundation, and then I hired with them. I ran campaigns with them. In university, I worked at the Big Brothers, the Boys and Girls Club in McCain and Vanier, Ottawa. I was a volunteer there. And working at different organizations allowed me to, one, understand volunteerism, structure of organization, the nonprofit sector, but also, two, to see gaps, to see where there wasn't direct support in terms of development, a leadership development, and access to opportunities to advance one's position in life, leadership opportunities, and just enjoyment of life weren't given to young Black girls and girls of color and immigrant girls, where it was a space just for them. And so when I went to Montreal and I was volunteering with different Black organizations there, I also saw there was no separation of, like, let's address issues that are pertaining to gender and based on gender discrimination. And so that inspired me to start For Us Girls based on what I saw where the gaps were.
Wow, that is wonderful. Your work is so important on many, many levels. I love that your logo is Be Fierce and Daring.
Yes. it's really about that. You have to just be fierce in life and daring at the same time.
Absolutely. And sometimes it doesn't come naturally for women. So that's great that you're teaching it and showing it by example as well. So you must have also drawn from your own experiences growing up. What obstacles did you face as a female minority growing up in Canada?
Well, I definitely face a lot. And I know sometimes, like, there is that generic because we're a person of color. But I felt like being a person of color and where I grew up was even more unique in Canada. I grew up in Kitchener-Waterloo. So it was a predominantly white town. Now it's a little bit more diverse. We do have members of parliament who are from Southeast Asian descendant backgrounds. But when I was growing up 20 something years ago in Kitchener, it was very, very white. The schools that I went to were white. I was the only person of color in my classes until I was in grade 4, where there was another Jamaican girl and then other students of different minority backgrounds. So being that, yes, that I was Black, I came from Jamaica. I didn't go to daycare here with kids. So I didn't necessarily have the time to develop those relationships. When I came here, I definitely stuck out because of my color, that I wasn't born here. And then also, too, just my natural compositions of being just an assertive, outspoken person. Now, things that we equate to great qualities, but, you know, 25 something years ago, and I'm sure even longer weren't necessarily celebrated qualities, especially in a Black person. So my challenges with my teachers were always finding that line of speaking up for myself and listening to them. And so there was always a fine line of where I felt like I was being asked to be quiet in times when I shouldn't have to be quiet and times where I had to learn to be quiet because I had so much to contain. So it really was a struggle finding my place, yes, as like a Black person, but also to a person, a woman who is confident and assertive and really knowing that the world doesn't celebrate that type of personality. So there was a lot of things going on, but I think what helped me was having, finally in high school, having teachers that I had two mentors that really just saw something special in me and really supported me and reaffirmed the qualities that I had that were looked as negative or challenging were actually positive things. And they showed me how to make them constructive. So I was able to balance the assertiveness. And then also too, they helped me find things about heritage. When my history teacher in grade 9, she told me about Africville in Nova Scotia. Like, she brought me literature about slaves that were brought to Canada and just learning about the path of, even for me, I'm born in Jamaica, so my language is through the Maroons, and the Maroons are like warriors and fighters in the mountains in Jamaica, and there's a connection to them in Nova Scotia. So she brought all this research to me, so I really was blessed to have her, because it really made a lot of clarity of a lot of years that were just really challenging and sad. But I also had a very strong mother, so every time I went home, it was kind of like, okay, we're going to go back out there, we're going to make sure you're smart, we're going to make sure you show them your talent. And I'm sure you experienced that as well too, kind of overcompensate with talent and academics to kind of mirror the racism and the discrimination.
That's a great story. I'm glad you shared that, because I think a lot of people can relate to that. So let's go back to your undergraduate days. What University of Ottawa course or experience has had the biggest impact on you?
I would say there was a few. There was definitely the PAP course, which us students in the public admin always played on that. It was the I can't remember the professor's name, but I remember she was a Russian descendant. And I believe that was in my first semester. It was in the fall. And I really liked that because it gave you an intro into just institutions, policies, and it made you understand, is this something that you really wanted to pursue? And it provided the foundations of, if you were going to go policy into the private sector, policy in the government sector. So I really liked that because it was kind of like, it explained more of what the program actually was. Because a lot of us in that program, to be honest, didn't really know what that actual program was. And then it was a lot of individuals in UOttawa, if they took, either if they were in economics or they took an economics class, was David Gray. He like stands out. He is like one of those just unicorn professors. And taking those two courses really stood out to me. And being able to have the application of both of them to apply my foundation of knowledge into the world was very impactful for me.
That's fantastic. And how impactful that you've had so many different professors have a big impact on you. All right, let's talk a bit about women leaders in the workplace. So do you think there's a difference between women leadership and men leadership?
Yes, 100%. As women, we're naturally known to be intuitive. We're naturally known to be decisive. And that can be what we were discussing before in our nature. We've been forced to make these decisions. And I think lots of times we forget that what makes us who we are and how we identify in the gender or the identity is actually a positive. I remember giving a keynote a couple of years ago. And what I talked about is that our leadership abilities, we need to fall on our naturalness that makes us a woman. And there's great leaders like Jacinda of New Zealand, and she speaks to that. She speaks to actually being a woman makes her a stronger person, because she relies on her education, she relies on her team, she relies on science, but she doesn't hinder the fact as a human how caring she is. And we've seen that when they had the really tragic mass shooting and how she just was there as a human. And I think, right or wrongfully, women have been placed in positions where we naturally had to care through a mothering. And even if you don't bear children, you somehow have to fulfill that role. So I think us in leadership, we women are thinking about the whole picture. We're thinking about, how does this affect every individual in our organization? How does it affect our partners, our supply chains? And then down the line, like sessions.
Right. Yet there are so few women leaders out there right now, and even fewer that are founders of companies. Why do you think this is?
I mean, there's definitely a lots of reasons. People can say lack of funding to go further. Certainly, we see so many companies that has boomed in the current COVID-19 pandemic, such as Clubhouse. There have been others. Shopify went higher status this past year and passing through the $1 billion threshold. And I think a lot of it, so those case studies and smaller ones are based on funding. So you see a lot of funds given towards women. And I would say, because I work at the intersection of, yes, funding, but the developmental aspect, for me, it starts earlier. And it connects and kind of explains the work that I do with my foundation and other things that I do, is that if a person doesn't perceive that they can lead, they're not going to lead. So you can provide all the funding available to them, but if they don't feel like they have the mentorship and the support to do so, it's going to be very difficult. And as much as we talk about we're in this new millennial and feminism, a lot of women do not have support through their families. Right now, we're seeing numbers of over 54 million have left the workplace because of COVID-19. The New York Times have been reporting, also to UN Women has been reporting, because they're doing childcare duties. And these are educated professional women. So at the end of the day, you can't throw money at a situation if you're not addressing the systemic issues. And that is lack of confidence, lack of support. Until we address the situations of people's households, nothing's going to really change on the outside, in society, in the boardrooms, in politics, because what you say to a woman who does naturally want to be married and does naturally want to have kids, you're making her choose. And it's sad, because most likely they're going to choose their family. So I think if we don't address that, we're really losing a lot of potential amazing leaders.
I totally agree. I think having that foundation, knowing that your family is in a good place, is then what makes you able to go out and work and do your own projects. But we've got to have that foundation in place. So that is great. I think you hit the nail right on the head. So you are president and CEO of Wolfram Tech Solutions. What influenced you to start this initiative?
Yes, so Wolfram Tech Solutions is actually a video conferencing platform. I was looking at different technologies, ones that were previously developed, open source, and I was looking at how initially I was thinking of something for women and girls, and I was thinking that this was about four years ago, 2017, 2016, when we were now discussing women's empowerment, girls' empowerment on a mainstream scale, and I said, wouldn't it be awesome if we had an online platform where women can create their own courses and share their knowledge and kind of like a masterclass. And now there's a lot of other competitors out there and different models that do that. And so that was the thinking. It was like, let's have this portal where women can create courses. And so when I developed it with my business partner at the time and my CTO, we had pitched it to different agencies actually here in New York City. And some of the feedback we got was they really liked the video conferencing platform. So this was way before Zoom, before Teams, before the pandemic. And so we were like, okay, that's really cool. So we explored that more. And then we create a web-based cloud video conferencing platform where you log on, you can join a meeting, and you do the same thing as we would do on Teams. So with a lot of back and forth, hesitation, and just being busy at the time before I became, I guess, a full-time entrepreneur, I was still working full-time as a professional corporate marketing professional, still traveling back and forth and running the foundation, that finally last year in April, I launched Wolfram Tech Solutions. So Wolfram Tech Solutions is the company and Wolfram Tech is the platform. So you could create your video conferencing calls, workshops, and seminars. So it's great for professional training, meetings, and educational purposes.
So let's talk about women in tech. So I saw a stat that software engineering has only 14% women of the total workforce. Why do you think there's so few women in tech?
Yes, this is a great question. I love talking about this. And so I did a lot of research myself. So about 3 years ago, I created a coding program for girls in Montreal. I think it's like not the first coding program in Montreal, because Canada Learning Codes and other ones have coding programs. But this was the first one where it was it was leadership development and part of it, because a lot of the coding programs were just one day. This was a 15-week coding program geared at low-income families of all ethnicities, because we wanted to reduce the access barrier. And so when I was developing that program and how to, we partnered with one of the school boards and how to outreach the different communities, I was researching that. And when I was reading about the that statistics, I was looking further at they have a graph that they show when girls drop off in science and math. And it's so funny because that I had similar experiences. So girls drop off in science and math actually before they get to high school. So 10 and 13, where the girls start being noticed by boys, and then they have that other awareness of the other gender, and boys start acting stupid in schools. And then studies have shown, and even the Canadian Women's Foundation have written about this, that that age demographic, just as they're transferring through junior high school to high school, is where they're getting aware that what we were talking about initially with my personality in school when you're younger, and our society doesn't necessarily reward those type of women, where they're realizing that they don't want to compete, they want to be seen as competing towards men. And society shows both financially, we don't pay them the same, and socially, we don't treat them the same. So why go ahead and continue competing men? So there is demographics and data that shows the drop off of girls in math class between grades 7, 8, 9, and 10. So by the time you get to grade 12, you don't have enough girls in advanced math and advanced calculus to continue to computer science. And then even if they do take math classes and advanced classes, they tend to go more into science fields. So they tend to go more into medicine and nursing and things like that, but not in computer science, where it's seen more as competitive and where male dominate. And there's another stream and in context to that, back in the 80s, there was at least 30% of women in computer science degrees and graduating was higher. And sometimes it was 40, it was very high. But what ended up happening was when I think it was Atari and video games started being marketed, and that changed everything. Because when you look at Microsoft and Melinda Gates talked about it all the time, there were more girls in her computer science program. There was actually more women than men, because they were taking a lot of women that were in the switchboard and to say, hey, we have a new system to do computers. So they were training them. So they had a lot of women in the force. But when the gaming came in, and then as you see what we did with gaming and war and et cetera, it was being marketed more to boys. So when you have that going on, and then you have the school board, to complete a computer science degree is very challenging. And then when you get to that point, it's very, very limited. So that's why my foundation, we run a coding program, and we target it to girls from low-income families, girls who are shy, and girls of color. And not only do we teach them how to code in languages like HTML, CSS, JavaScript, Python as beginner, but we also bring in women of color and other women who work in the field. There's a graphic designer, a gamer, they run their own tech company, so they can see that taking these courses relate to an actual career.
Education does seem to be the answer. So that is why your work is so powerful. I think having the opportunities, making it easy for women or girls to be with other girls similar to themselves in an environment where it's maybe less competitive and more supportive and collaborative, that seems to be a great way to make it different from the current experience that it is. So you're a goalkeeper with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Tell us about this.
When was that? 2019, one of our partners and a mentor of mine at SAP, in New York City, she nominated me for the work that I was doing with the New Reality with girls in tech and coding and just mentorship overall. And so they nominated me to be a goalkeeper. And I guess basically what that means, you get to be a champion of the work that the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is doing. And what they do, they select about, I think it's less than 100, it's a very small number from throughout the world, to come to New York City, join the United Nations General Assembly Week. And you have about 3 days training, where you get training from their team of how to kind of scale your projects better, how to build teams and things like that. So they select you to kind of recognize you for your work. And then they give you some, which is, we all do need that developmental training to kind of like, you're doing great work, we recognize you, let's continue developing on it. And then you're also then a part of their goalkeepers ecosystems, and then you contribute to their reports and contribute to some of their projects that they're doing throughout the world. And I guess it's kind of seen as some way of like a council of change makers and thought leaders on these different issues. And then I guess like the big event you get to attend their Goalkeepers event, that it's like a nice little gala with Bill and Melinda Gates there, and they go over their report of the year. And honestly, for me, the best highlight was, you do meet other really great change makers, but Bill Gates is really, really brilliant. Like, you know, we know about his work, but when you get to stand there and listen to him talk about, he's really smart, and so is Melinda. Like, they're really, really smart. And I like that type of perspective when it comes to, now we used to call it international development and humanitarian, but now I guess it's rebranded to social entrepreneurship, whichever term you want to use. What I do like about their model is based on data. And I think moving forward, we as a society, if this pandemic has shown us anything, data is so important, and so in science. So I really like that model. So being a goalkeeper, it really aligns you with what they're doing. Even as you continue doing your own work as your own foundation, you get to rely on them and have access to different opportunities, resources, fundings, and support. But yeah, it was a great opportunity, and just listening to them and watching their data perspective, it's really inspiring, because it shows you, okay, what are you doing with your organization, and how are you quantifying your impact? How are you tracking the impact? What are the numbers you're showing? And these are great questions, because I find in this sector, you're not always taught that as much. So it's really good to be able to be reminded, because regardless if you're doing community work, charity work, or for-profit work, you got to show your numbers. You got to show, if somebody gives you $500, how impactful was that $500? And before I give you another $500, what are you going to do with that? So I've definitely enjoyed having access to that training, knowledge, and support.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, having that ROI quantitative results is important when you're looking for funding. So that's great that you can have that training and also be with peers, so to learn from each other as well. That's exactly. Great. So with all your experiences, what do you think we can do in our day-to-day lives? So, you know, we're students, we're just people in our day-to-day lives. What can we do to make a difference between equality and equity for women?
Yes, that's a really great question. And like I said, it all starts with university. All of my activism started with university. I was on the board of directors for the Student Federation. I ran different clubs. It's really in our individual lives. So one, how are you treating the woman in your lives? And then two, are there any opportunities that you see that you could sponsor a woman for? Such as you might see a fund or grant or inside job. Don't just send it to someone. Do a referral. Hi, I think this would be a great opportunity for you because .. Would you like me to do a sponsor referral? I have got things in life when I've had that sponsor referral, or things have gone quicker when I've had that sponsor referral. It's funny, I applied to be a goalkeeper with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and I was actually selected when I had somebody sponsor me and applied for me. So right for a wrongfully, we know that's what moves things forward. It moves what they say, the needle forward. So really, showing up for other people and holding space for them when you hear comments that are not conducive to what you believe in or safe and productive society should be, speak up. But then go further when you see opportunities and create opportunities for other people. I think those are the really main things, is that treating people well and how can you do better? How can you be safe? How can you make sure, especially in the university context, a girl is walked home safe, right? How can you be a friend and be a buddy? I know when we went to university that year, there was a lot of date rape situations that were happening in Frosh Week, and there was like alert being sent out. And so, but the messaging wasn't always best, but again, it goes back to, what are we doing as communities? What are you doing as a male student, or how are you identified, to make sure other people are safe? What are you watching out to see what's happening? The conversations that are being said in your program, that's about a certain ethnicity, right? Because we laugh that it's just like university talk, but that university talk goes into the boardroom. Like, boardroom people weren't always boardroom people. They were like young college students at one point that never changed. And now they're like, you know, the somewhat of a cancer of the world that we're now trying to figure out. But we had that problem years ago. So like, nip it in the butt, many people would say. And sponsor people for opportunities. Those are the best things to do, and create those opportunities. I think once we don't need to start organizations, but you could do it in a way in your job. You can ask, hey, I noticed we haven't hired any Aboriginal people. Like, what's going on? Like, are we looking for any Aboriginal candidates? What type of relationships do we have with the Indigenous community? Maybe go to the Indigenous Student Association at different campuses to let them know about the internship. Sometimes you have to be directly intentional in the support that you want to do, because if you just say, well, we just want great candidates, that's very vague. It's very vague. And sometimes that vague can be skewed to discrimination. So go and be an intentional. And I think we all have that responsibility. Like I said, if you were able to go to university, regardless of where you came from a low income, high income family, international, domestic, you're still privileged. You're still able to access education at a higher level. And so I think if we're just really cognizant of that world that we have, and to pay forward in the world, like, you got this education, now what are you going to do with it to make the world better? It's not to say you can't make money. You can. The world needs money, but I don't think that's ever the conversation. The conversation has always been about what you've done when you made money, or how did you make money? Was it in a moral way that you make money? Are you ripping people off? Are you ripping the environment off? So I think it all comes down to just a whole ecosystem of how do we want to see the world. And I believe equity and equality towards women is a part of that. You can't be trash to the environment and then say I support women, because that affects women as well too, right? You can't just be like, oh well, I love dogs, but then be trash to not hire any women. Like, I just don't understand that. They're not intertwined. Like, it doesn't make sense. So I believe students right now at U Ottawa, you guys have a great challenge on your hands, but I believe you have all the resources to make the solutions that you want if you want to do that.
Yeah, love it. Step up, speak up, support others. That's great. It's great to see all the strides, but there's still a lot of work to be done.
Yes. Yeah.
So looking back, what would you have said to yourself, or what advice would you have given to yourself as an undergrad student?
I would have said, an undergrad student, travel more over abroad. I definitely did travel. I think after school, travel more abroad. And then to start sooner, start your own project sooner. That's what I tell my young girls now, because what I tell them about when we run our entrepreneurship program is, even if you don't want to be an entrepreneur, even if you want to work for the big four companies of the world, still start something, because the skills that you learn in being an entrepreneur or having a side hustle, it makes you a better employee. It makes you a better manager. If you want to be C-suite level, you want to run an organization, but you haven't even run a little like bake shop, like, you know, so it's like, those things that you do outside of school matter, and to be able to learn how to translate them onto your resume, because that matters so much right now. Is if you run a reading camp, position it into a way as you run like a small business, a small enterprise that was focused on forward educational assistance support. So that's what I would tell myself, was travel more abroad in your university studies. It's okay to take some time off, a semester off, or a year off, because it gives you clarity. And start your own little project in university and a business, even if it's just for the experience or something that you want to carry. Because if you started something when you were 22 and you're 28, that's 6 years of business experience that you can either add to give you an MBA leadership track, or you can add to kind of continue to give your own income.
Wonderful. That is great advice. Okay, we like to end with a rapid fire. We want to get into the mindset of an entrepreneur, see how you think, and see how you would react. So it's a bunch of questions. Just first answer that comes to your mind. Text or phone call?
Phone calls if it's like a real conversation with somebody, yes.
Fit in an early workout or get more sleep?
I'm trying to be more fit, so early workout.
Multitask or one task at a time?
I'm a Gemini. I'm a multitasker.
Big picture thinking or detail oriented?
Can I say both? I'm a big picture person, but details are important.
I love it. You got to make it happen, right? Follow rules or break rules?
Break the rules.
Your personal mantra?
Personal mantra, I want to live life with a little bit of humor, style, and some compassion, and do good. That's a paraphrase of Maya Angelou.
Something on your bucket list?
Write a book, yeah.
Ooh, activist who inspires you.
Activist that inspires me. I think Gretchen, yeah. What she's been doing with Climate Fridays, and then all the other activists as well. There's one from Uganda as well. It's really inspiring watching those young girls do their thing.
Yep. Describe yourself in a hashtag.
Hashtag style and grace and humor.
Love it. Your best pinch me moment.
Pinch me moment? I think is when I did the Vanity Fair shoot with Emma Watson. I still can't get over that. I think that was just, it was glamorous.
Wow, that's great. Best gift you've given yourself recently?
I bought a really nice dress from Mango.
You deserve it. And favorite way to de-stress?
Candles and light music, yeah.
Fantastic. Aminka, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us today. We've learned so much. Where can we find out more about you and your organizations?
Yes, of course. Thank you so much, The Link. Thank you so much, Sharon. It's been my honor. I'm so excited to have been featured. Thank you so much for sharing my story. I can be found at www.aminka, A-M-I-N-K-A, Velvet, V-E-L-V-I-T-T.com, or forusgirls.org, and wolffemtech.com.
Wonderful. Keep up the great work. We are cheering you on.
Thank you so much.